Hi, my name is George Hobach. Welcome to my new talk about Einstein's true legacy, which of course is local symmetry, and local symmetry means sameness. Albert Einstein was able to demonstrate scientifically that the local dynamic laws of nature are the same everywhere and all the time. And by doing so, he was also able to demonstrate that local symmetry is actually nature's core principle, and nature, of course, is the cosmos. Albert Einstein himself was fully aware of the central role of local symmetry. That's why he would have preferred to call his theory of relativity invariance theory. Invariance is a technical term which states that something is invariant, which means it does not change. And if something does not change, it stays the same, it stays symmetric. And the thing that stays symmetric are, of course, the local dynamic laws of nature. And I want to kick off and start off this talk today with two quotes, or three quotes rather, one by Albert Einstein and then two other famous physicists. In his book Ideas and Opinions, Einstein said, "I hold it true that pure thought can grasp reality as the ancients dreamed." So that's what we want to explore today, how by thinking about the universe with the help of the insights of physicists, especially Einstein, we can understand why the universe looks the way it does, as we have discovered it so far, and why it had to emerge the way it did. And another famous physicist, Anthony C., in his book Fearful Symmetry, he wrote, "I regard Einstein's understanding of how symmetry dictates design as one of the truly profound insights in the history of physics." And dictating design means, of course, or refers to the structure and the way nature looks. And then the last quote comes from Frank Wilczek, also a famous physicist, a Nobel Prize laureate, from his book A Beautiful Question. And in it he writes, "Plato's vision to derive structure from symmetry is one that echoes through the ages. The idea that there is symmetry at the root of nature has come to dominate our understanding of physical reality. The far-fetched idea that symmetry dictates structure has become, at the unmapped frontiers of the unknown, our guiding star." So Wilczek points out that this understanding that symmetry is at the root of nature goes back to at least Plato, and we now want to take a closer look at this concept and how it unfolds and creates a universe. So let's imagine you're in the position to create a universe. And the first question you have to decide is, do I want to organize this universe, this creation, globally from a central point, or do I want to organize it and create it locally? And intuitively, probably most of you, like myself, would argue that the best way to go about this is to organize it from a global intelligence system or point of view. And the problem, though, is when you think about it more profoundly, you will realize that once the universe really starts getting bigger, you eventually need infinite speed to transmit information instantly to reach every far away point or entity. And then when you have infinite speed, things get very confusing because you can no longer decide what comes first, what comes second, what is before and after, and who is really saying what. And then you would have to become really control obsessed in a way to be the boss of everything still, because you want to organize it globally in this option here. And so essentially you come to the conclusion it just doesn't work. This is not economical. Infinity, if you use it as infinite speed, just messes things up. And so the other way is to go about it in a local fashion, and this is really what nature has done with its fundamental concept of local symmetry. And I now want to explore in more detail how nature is sticking to its central principle and how it unfolds in the cosmos. And Werner Heisenberg, in his book, German title, Schritt über Grenzen, in English, Steps Across Borders, he highlights that there are two fundamental constants in nature that help nature to implement local symmetry. And the first one is the quantum of action. This is this point here. It's actually has no dimension. It was discovered by Max Planck and he called it age. And Einstein then said, this is not just a hypothetical idea, it's really reality, that this is something that exists. And age is defined as the smallest constant unit of action. And small, of course, means local, and constant means sameness, so it's symmetric. So age, this little point here of energy, represents local symmetry on the smallest of scales. And I want to read to you how small this is. This is from Brian Greene's book, The Elegant Universe. And he says, with respect to Planck length, it's a millionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a centimeter, 10 to the minus 33 centimeter. So you can see how incredibly small it is and how important for nature it is to make this statement on the smallest of scales, that local symmetry is fundamental and is the foundation on which everything is built. And so this is the first constant. It's a standard that is being set on the small scale. Now, as I pointed out, this quantum of action is the smallest constant unit of action, and action is energy, kinetic energy, it's motion. And so you can comprehend or guess that we also need a second constant, and this is the constant speed of light, c, in empty space. And this constant actually refers to this motion in terms of a maximum speed. Okay, and c itself, as I said, is constant, so this is symmetric, but it's also a local dynamic law, because it's true everywhere and all the time. That's one of the amazing characteristics of the cosmos, that everywhere and all the time you can measure that light speed c is constant. So again, it's a representation of local symmetry, this time with respect to energy, to motion. It makes clear that there is a local symmetry aspect that needs to be adhered to. And why is this important? In the beginning, when I suggested we start imagining how we would create a universe, we realized we cannot go global, because global means you need infinite speed. And when you have infinite speed, you cannot recognize anything anymore. And that's why this constant speed of light is so important, because this limit allows you to be aware of the fact that there is more, something bigger, that there is infinity actually. Because infinity is not a number, it's a mathematical concept. And it is very important to understand that how crucial infinity is, because in order to be a central principle, you have to be general, you have to be all-inclusive, you need to have infinity in your toolbox. But when you use infinity as infinite speed, as I said, then you won't be able to recognize infinity anymore, and then you cannot be a central, fundamental, all-underpinning principle. And that's the problem with going global. It just doesn't work as a fundamental concept. And again, this is why nature chose local symmetry. And we can also realize that this has to do with awareness, because you need to be aware that there is infinity to be all underpinning. And this also goes in the direction that Einstein was talking about once. It is from his book, What I Believe. Infinity, I want to point out, is open. You cannot put a number on it, you cannot put a lid on it, so it's open like something mysterious even. And so Einstein said the following, again from his book, What I Believe. The most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious. It is the source of all true art and science. He to whom this emotion is a stranger, who can no longer pause to wonder and stand wrapped in awe, is as good as dead. His eyes are closed. This insight into the mystery of life has also given rise to religion. Now again, as I explained before, if you use infinity in the wrong way, like with infinite speed, then this concept of being global just collapses, and it's just not feasible. Einstein talks about it in a different way. He says, if you're no longer aware of mystery, of this mysterious aspect of reality, which is infinity, your eyes are closed and you're dead, which kind of refers to what I've been saying. It just doesn't work, and then things get really messed up. And another famous physicist and Nobel Prize laureate, David Cross, in the article The Role of Symmetry in Fundamental Physics from 1996, he said the following: the secret of nature is symmetry. And the secret, of course, is something mysterious, and the mysterious thing is the concept of infinity. And as I pointed out, it's very, very crucial for nature to work, because we need something, some point of orientation, something fundamental, something reliable, and this is local symmetry, because it contains infinity, as we will see. Now, as I have pointed out before, physicists are aware of the fact that local symmetry is central in nature. However, they have always been very vague about this concept. They are not really sure how to define it. Surprisingly, sometimes it's one idea, then it's several ideas that converge into a simple logic system, and sometimes they have sentences that define symmetry in a way that makes sense, but they never can really present you a mathematical structure, even though they know it's mathematical. And so let's try to bring more clarity into this field here. And I want to start off by discussing this unitary principle, as they sometimes call symmetry, because it's fundamental. And let's suppose symmetry is just one idea. If it's just one idea, what does it mean? It's like being global again, it's rigid, you need infinite speed to organize it, it does not work. So the next step would be to argue, what about two ideas? If you really have two ideas, then they are separated. And when they are separated, they are so different that they have nothing in common anymore, and then they cannot interact. Actually, Henri Poincaré, a famous mathematician and contemporary of Einstein, he once talked about the fact that nature is a wholeness, a oneness, which means the separate or seemingly separate parts of nature are actually fundamentally one, otherwise they couldn't interact. So we know two ideas doesn't work. And then what about three ideas? And I would suggest that three ideas really is the way to go. Plato also said that two things cannot be combined without a third element, and this third element is this bond of union. And that's also one I want to highlight very quickly. Here we have this bond, I drew it here, between Planck's constant, the symmetry, local symmetry on the small scale, and the constant speed of light, which is this maximum speed representation of local symmetry, and they too are interconnected. Here the quantum of action as a quantum system also has to adhere to the constant speed of light, so that the universe functions very well. In other words, that the structure of local symmetry can be manifested on every level then. But let's get back to this concept of three ideas. And so for instance, Henri Poincaré, this famous mathematician that I had referred to before, in his book The Foundations of Science, he says, "Science, in other words, is a system of relations. It is relations alone which can be regarded as objective. It is this bond which is the object in itself, and this bond is a relation." He also goes on to say, "Mathematical analysis, without this language, we should forever have been ignorant of the internal harmony of the world, which is, we shall see, the only true objective reality. The best expression of this harmony is law. We should be astonished at nature's regularity. The world is divine because it has harmony." And the question, of course, is how can we really define harmony? How can we make a statement that says we have symmetry, we have equivalence, we have equality? And here, Leon Lederman and Christopher Hill, both two noted physicists, Lederman was also a Nobel Prize laureate, in their book Symmetry and the Beautiful Universe, they write, "Symmetry intimately involves the most basic of mathematical concepts, equivalence. When two things are the same thing or equivalent in mathematics, we say that they are equal, and we use the ubiquitous equal sign." Okay, And that's what I wrote down here. We have these two identical magnets on either side of the equal sign. So the equal sign is what Henri Poincaré said is the relation. It's this harmony concept. It's the only objective reality in nature. And these two identical or symmetric concepts, these represented by these magnets, they are indeed the same. We have one and we have another one. The other one, or the first one, you can label number one because it's a mathematical concept. And the next one you could say it's number two, but you can also argue that this is number one again because they are identical. This is one and this is one. And this is really what sameness is. It is total sameness, total equivalence. And then this gives you the first level of local symmetry, which is sameness. And sameness, as the word implies, is independent of everything. Otherwise, it wouldn't be sameness all the time and everywhere. So it's even independent of space and time. Okay, the first level. However, you can also argue that this second unit here really is number two. And then you would focus on the fact that number two is the larger number. It's the additional number. And this then, as you can see, opens up a new level, because these two numbers here actually then represent property spaces, mathematical property spaces. Number one related to number two would be small and concentrated and added up. Number two is the larger number, the additional number, the extra number, and all these terms, they don't have a limit. So number two even includes infinity, this openness, and openness and being additional, or additionality includes action, implies it, and so it also represents energy, and energy is action. So the second level of local symmetry is the action level. And as you can see, this sequence here from one to number two also gives you a direction of evolution of motion from number one into the larger property space. However, because there's this relationship bond here, there can also be an interaction, a dialogue between these two property spaces. And so you have these two levels, the sameness level, that's the upper level, and below you have the action level. And sameness, as I said, does not change, and action implies motion, activity, so they seem to be very distinct. However, they come from the same unity concept, so we know even though they are distinct, they have to be fundamentally equivalent. And I want to give you real quick, I hope I can find it, here it is, a definition of symmetry by Frank Wilczek, the famous physicist, Nobel Prize laureate. It's from his book, The Lightness of Being, and he defines symmetry in this way. Symmetry means you have a distinction without a difference. And this is really true for the two levels of local symmetry here, sameness and action. And then the next question we would have to ask, and that takes us then a step further, is why is, you can see this is essentially the equal sign. Why is the equal sign these two stretched out dimensions and focus points? And the thing is, we know, since they come from the same system, that they can also be seen as united locally. So if we take this point and put it on top of the other point, you will no longer be able to recognize any difference, or know that these are that there are two points actually. So points do not really work. However, if you have these two dimensions, you will be able to realize that you can interconnect or intersect them in a local fashion, so that they can manifest their unity and still be different. And that's what I drew here. If you take the red line and turn it into a vertical position, then it intersects with the horizontal line in a point. Okay, we have the point idea again. This is this aspect from number one property space being local, united, concentrated, added up. So you have these two dimensions consisting of the red vertical line and the blue horizontal line. But then you can also argue that the second aspect, which can see itself as a unit, but it can also see itself as these two points. That's what number two is. It can be the second, it can be a unit, or it can be two things, because this is self-referential. Number two refers back to the beginning because of the equal sign. And then you can argue that number two, as I said, is two things or two dimensions. And we already have one, two. But if the blue line number two argues I'm more than just one, you can add another dimension, the third dimension, and you're allowed to do this in a right angle relationship. And the right angle relationship really, as I said, allows you to be as different as possible, but still manifest the unity that there is. And this then, you've probably guessed it already, gives you three-dimensional space. That's where we find ourselves in. And since this is more like an added up configuration of number one plus number two property space, added up comes from number one property space, three-dimensional space represents sort of this number one property space in an added up configuration. However, you can also count, right? You have one, two, three dimensions, and counting is more from this open property space, and counting of course is time. So included in this three-dimensional space is the fourth dimension of time, which is not really visible. When you look at the three dimensions, it becomes more visible again when you look at two dimensions, but this is not part of what I want to discuss today with you. And here, light speed c, the constant light speed c, which is a representation of local symmetry, since it's always the same, it always guarantees you that space and time have a symmetric relationship, a locally symmetric relationship. This is necessary so that everybody, independent of their state of motion, whether they are at rest, which would be number one property space, you're added up, you're not moving, or you're more in this number two property space where you're moving, independent of your state of motion, independent of where you are, whether you are on planet Earth or on a bigger planet where there are more gravitational effects, the space-time relationship is fixed, is locally symmetric, so that locally you can always measure that light speed c is constant in nature. So you can see how light speed c is this big unifier, because it comes out of this infinite space configuration. It refers back to number one, so it unifies everything, and that's also why this point here, the quantum of action as a system, has to respect light speed c. And you can then understand why every level that we have encountered so far is based on local symmetry. And this then also, as I said, or indicated, gives you the different realities, that of the small scale of quantum mechanics, because this little guy here, the quantum of action, which represents local symmetry, defines the small scale, number one. It is equal to number two, so the quantum hops over into number two property space, which contains infinity, which contains counting, like circular motion. And then the quantum of action gives you all the quantum mechanical features, like infinity means it's all over space, and this rotational aspect, which I explained in previous talks, gives you the wave feature that is like a corkscrew pattern that stretches out from minus to plus infinity. And the quantum, since it's the small scale by definition, is doing it all by itself, so we cannot really observe it. When we observe it, then we start coming from this number two property space. It's a different direction of looking at reality. And when you have more, you're relating back to number one, things start adding up, and then the quantum that has been all over place suddenly becomes localized again and has a defined history. Also, when you're looking from onto reality from this large scale property space that refers back to this number one concept here, you can understand things are getting round, so space gets warped, and this is what we have with gravity. So you can really see that all the different levels, the different interactions, are all based on local symmetry, and physicists have confirmed that. Now the question, of course, is why can we also argue that this is consciousness? As I said, we have this a whole system that consists of three parts. We have these two property spaces, which if you look at them individually, they may look differently to you, but we know that they are fundamentally the same, so they are distinct and they have no difference. And it was Einstein who revealed why they are not, or why they are the same, why they are equivalent, because the local dynamic laws of nature are the same everywhere and all the time, which means they are the same in number one property space, which would be added up, being at rest. And they are the same in number two property space, which is energy, which is motion. Nature doesn't care. For nature, this is both the same. Local symmetry is this relationship concept, including infinity, so it's nature's fundamental principle. And the laws, the local dynamic laws of nature, are also relationship concepts. That's why they're the same in both property spaces. And Einstein really revealed that. Now, as I said, these two property spaces, they are distinct, but they are not different. And so, because of this central equal sign, they are in a relationship. And Henri Poincaré said this is the only true objective. This is harmony. And since they are aware of each other and they are identical, they are self-aware, okay? And self-awareness means if you consider the wholeness system, this is consciousness. So at the bottom of reality, we actually have consciousness. So the whole universe is a conscious experience. In physics, you can also argue, is about understanding consciousness. And I want to give you a quote in this respect by Max Planck, also, of course, a famous physicist and Nobel Prize laureate. And in his interview, The Observer, he said, "I regard consciousness as fundamental. I regard matter as derivative from consciousness. We cannot get behind consciousness. Everything that we talk about, everything that we regard as existing, postulates consciousness." And the better we understand local symmetry, the better we can understand really why this whole universe is a conscious manifestation. And Einstein, for instance, he once wrote in a response letter to a young girl named Phyllis in 1936, "Everyone who is seriously involved in the pursuit of science becomes convinced that a spirit is manifest in the laws of the universe, a spirit vastly superior to that of man." And of course, if you call it a spirit or consciousness or awareness, that's essentially always the same thing. And it is vastly superior, this fundamental spirit, because, as I have pointed out, it has infinity in its toolbox. And this is very important. Again, why? Because you want to have a general statement that can be underpinning everything. And so you need to be careful how you treat infinity. And as I said, nature is really going out of its way to make sure it honors the infinity aspect by making the statement on the smallest of scales that local symmetry is central, and then by repeating it with the constant light speed c to really make sure it can stay aware of infinity, because it is consciousness, so it needs this awareness to function. Now, Nobel Prize laureate Leon Lederman, together with his colleague Christopher Hill, both physicists, they wrote in their book Symmetry in the Beautiful Universe, "The perspectives offered by symmetry," and symmetry is always local symmetry, "it is imperative that we try to give the non-scientific members of society, who through democratic processes make the final decisions, a better understanding of the key issues. In fact, our future depends on it." And now we can hopefully understand better why understanding local symmetry is so essential. Lederman and Hill even argue in their book that really everybody should study local symmetry, beginning with children at the kindergarten level. And as I pointed out before, because if you come to the conclusion, "I want to organize things globally," you're totally out of touch, out of harmony with the consciousness that manifests the universe. What's important, as I said, is local symmetry. However, human beings, time and again, they think intuitively, and I can understand that organizing everything from a central vantage point, from an essential intelligence system, is the way to go. But this structure here, nature tells us that this doesn't work. Especially then, if you think you can use mathematics or artificial intelligence to start controlling or organizing everything, again, it does not work. And why? Because this, even though this is a mathematical concept, which represents Plato's mathematical world, the actual part that represents the mathematics that we are used to, like equations and algorithms and stuff like that, this is only a small part because of the infinity term. Infinity means there is something extremely large, goes on forever, that you cannot compute. And I've quoted in previous talks Roger Penrose, I think from his book The Emperor's New Mind, in which he says that we have this mathematical Platonic world, the math that we usually talk about is part of it, but there's also a much bigger part that's full of mystery, full of fantasy, full of imagination, and you cannot control that. And as I said, nature, in order to organize itself, goes local. And since this is self-referential, it uses in life this concept of circularity. These are the metabolisms we find in nature. And the thing about the circle is it's the most symmetric form. You can rotate it, not important, infinitely many times without causing any change to the shape. So it means you're using infinity in a most symmetric form and fashion, and these circularity concepts can then interact and create a unity network based on local metabolisms. So that's nature's supreme intelligence. And when you start going global, linear, and controlling everything, then you're cutting yourself off actually from much of infinity, which then still is infinity, and you're starting to destroy these relationship concepts and the circularity. And then I don't think that this is a very wise way to go about things. And that's why I agree with Ledermann and Hill that we really should study local symmetry and integrate it well, so that we can better harmonize ourselves with this overall intelligence that has created the reality that we are part of. And this basically concludes my talk for today. And as always, I want to close off my talk by giving you two quotes from Albert Einstein with respect to this wonderful mathematical structure here. As a young boy, he said the following, and this is a quote is from it's a magazine, The Tower. Einstein was talking to the high school reporter Henri Rousseau, and he said, "As a boy of 12 years making my acquaintance with elementary mathematics, I became more and more convinced that even nature could be understood as a relatively simple mathematical structure." And then in his lecture on the method of theoretical physics in 1933, as a celebrated physicist, Einstein said, "Based on our experiences so far, we have reason to be confident that nature is the realization of the simplest conceivable mathematical structure." So this was my talk for today. I hope you enjoyed it. You can always subscribe to my channel. Activate the notification bell, which is spectacular fun, and I hope to see you next time. Bye bye!